Good morning. Am I on? Am I on? Testing 1, 2. Yeah?
Or is it just me and my big booming voice? Okay. Let me start over.
Good morning and welcome to Oakland Presbyterian Church. So glad that you are here. Welcome to all of you. Let's begin our time together with a call to worship. You will see the words if you have a bulletin in front of you, but also we'll have the words up on the screen. So let's begin. Gather us in, Lord, and hear our prayers. Gather us in, Lord. And heal our spirits. Gather us in, Lord, and open our hearts to receive your word. Amen. Let's join together in a prayer of confession again in your bulletin and up on the screen. We'll pray this prayer together. And then I'm going to give you some moments for silence, meditation, just to be in God's presence. And then I'll bring you back with some good news for all of us. So let's pray together. Gather us in, Lord, and hear our prayers. Gather us in, Lord, and heal our spirit. Gather us in, Lord, and open our hearts to receive your word. Gracious God, we come before you and we just unburden ourselves. We ask, God, that you would help us to admit and confess all the ways that we have heard your call but not responded. All the ways you have asked us to turn to you and we have turned away. All the ways you have asked us to be of service to our neighbor and we have neglected or ignored them. Forgive us for all the things that we have said or done that we shouldn't have said or done. And forgive us for the things that we should have said and did not. Hear us as we pray to you our own personal prayer of confession. Friends, hear the good news. Do not be afraid. God's love is reaching out to you to touch your hurt and to heal your wounds and to provide you with his peace. Receive God's blessing and be assured of God's eternal love for you. Believe the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You are forgiven and you are free. Thanks be to God. And now, let's share that peace with each other. Go to as many people as you can get to in about 30 seconds and share the peace of Christ with them.
And now at this time, I invite all the children to join me for Children's Church.
From Psalm 119, verses 105 through 108. Your word is a lamp for my feet, a light on my path. I have taken an oath and confirmed it, that I will follow your righteous laws. I have suffered much. Preserve my life, Lord, according to your word. Accept, Lord, the willing praise of my mouth and teach me your laws. This is the word of the Lord.
So we're going to dig into that. But first, a little bit of housekeeping. If you have a phone, we're going to put it to good use right now. Point it at the QR code in front of you, and that'll take you to an app for our church, and lots of stuff there, but the thing we really want you to do as soon as you can is fill out the connection card. So push that button and give all the information that's asked for, and this is for everybody. It's kind of the way we keep attendance and know who's here, and if somebody hasn't been coming for a while, it helps us to know that, and we can reach out and make sure that they're okay. And so thank you for providing that. Then also through the app, it's a primary way that we do communion. And so thank you for how you're supporting the mission and the work of the church, not only in these four walls, but outside in the community as well. And then if you don't want to use your phone, that's fine too. We have a paper connection card. And then if you brought an offering in hand, that's great. We really appreciate it. You can take the card offering, and there's a drop box that you can, you'll walk by when you leave out in the narthex, and there's one just right over here. And we're just glad you're here. We're having fellowship today after the service in our fellowship hall, and we'd love to have you join for some cookies and refreshments and just getting to know each other a little bit better. And then also, we are celebrating communion today, and if you don't have the little communion packet yet, the little prepackaged communion, looks like an hourglass, then please raise your hand. We want to make sure that you get one, and our ushers are ready to make sure that you have one. Looks like everybody is ready to go. By the way, if you are a guest or a visitor, but you are a follower of Jesus, you're a Christian, you are more than welcome to participate in communion with us. This isn't our church's table, it's the Lord's table for all those who are following Christ in communion together. So we just celebrate you're here and hope that you'll join us for communion as well. Okay, I think I got all that out of the way. Now, there's two things that I want to talk with you about today. The first thing has to do specifically with the Old Testament. There's just some tips, some tricks of the trade that I have picked up through my time, and I'd like to give to you so that we kind of as a church raise our starting point in terms of knowledge of the Bible, because if we're able to do that, then that creates more space for us to reach even higher and deeper so that we can know God's Word, apply it to our lives. And so for your Old Testament, I'm going to give you a few pointers. And the first pointer is this, that the Old Testament is best understood as being divided into three very distinct sections. Some of you may know this, but some of you may not. There are three sections, and this is a slide that I use pretty much every time we're introducing a new book. And this is the layout of the entire Old Testament. New Testament's not in there yet. That's a different slide. So this is the whole Old Testament, all of the books laid out in order, but notice that they are organized according to section that that book belongs to. And it really gets to the intent of the book and the literary style of the book. So at the beginning of the Bible, the first section, it's all history. It is an account of what happens with God creating and being a part of the whole creation. But then it narrows down specifically as God is dealing with a family, and then that family becomes the nation of Israel. And so it reveals what God is doing through relationship with those people. So the first five books of the Bible are grouped together and are historically, traditionally called the Torah or the Law. And then from Exodus to exile, you can see that those are the books in order. There's a little bit of overlap there, telling that whole span of history. Then the Bible breaks, the Old Testament breaks, and a new type of literature begins. And this section is called either poetry or wisdom, depending on who you ask. Poetry or wisdom. And what's in this section is humanity's way of responding to God. How humanity has responded to what God is doing in creation and with Israel. And they do that by psalm and song and proverb and sermon. It's all in there in terms of all the various ways that people have responded to God, and that's in wisdom. By the way, if you turn your Bible, your paper Bible, to the middle, if you just kind of try to find the middle and you turn right to it, yep, I turn to Proverbs. You'll always be in that poetry wisdom setting. And so you can kind of go wherever you need to go from there. And then finally, prophecy. That's the third and last section of the Old Testament. And this is just simply a lot of different ways that warning and encouragement and exhortation is being presented by God to the people through a prophet, giving them instruction and encouragement to stay on the path, to stay faithful, to stay close to God and obedient to God. But it also has a lot of warning in there about what happens, what the consequences are of going off the path, turning away from God as the Israelite people did. So that gives you, oh, by the way, with prophecy, sometimes there's a division between major prophets and minor prophets. And it has nothing to do with the importance of the books. That's not what major, minor means. It simply has to do with the length of the book, how long the books are. They're big, long books, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. Lamentations is kind of an add-on to Jeremiah. And then there's a whole collection of just little books, not very long, some only a chapter long. And those are the minor prophets. And that's the only reason they're called major and minor prophets. So now you have a navigation tool. But it also helps you to realize that the chronology of the Bible overlaps a lot. So if you look at this, the next slide, please. You probably can't see this in great detail, but it just illustrates the fact that chronologically, these books are overlapping and they're all over the place. In other words, it's not correct to assume that if you read the Old Testament from beginning to end, it's one continuous story all the way through. Kind of like when you read a novel, you know, the story starts with page one, and then in the last page, that's where the story comes to an end. That's not the way the Old Testament works. That everything kind of overlaps in terms of when it was written and what setting. And so what you kind of want, I think, in a Bible that you're using is something that has a book introduction. Because that book introduction will give you an idea of where you are in the history of Israel, in the history of the Old Testament. I also think it's a good idea, if you're studying Scripture, to have a tool at hand which will help illuminate the original language of the Old Testament, which was not English. It is Hebrew. 99% of the Old Testament is written in Hebrew. The other 1% is Aramaic, which is very close to Hebrew. And if you buy a book, then I recommend that you get a lexicon or a concordance, just as a sort of supplemental resource for your reading of the Bible. If you come across a word that you don't understand or you're wondering what the author meant, then those tools will help you to know what that word in the Hebrew means. But if you don't want a book, then there are wonderful resources online that what you're looking for is something that gives you what's called Strong's Concordance number that you can click for a word, and that'll take you to the Hebrew word. So you can learn a little bit about what it means. And anybody can use this. This is what I use every week in preparation for preaching to you. And you can use it too in understanding the Old Testament. And the last little bit of advice I would give you is, you know, open up the Bible to the table of contents, look at the Old Testament, and really either memorize or get a sense for the order of the books in the Old Testament. In the digital age, when all we need is a search engine, you know, it just kind of goes to the verse, and we lose where it occurs, right, in the span of the Old Testament. And to me, that's really, really helpful to know. So get used to knowing where books are, so if you go to a particular passage, you know where you are in the Old Testament. Okay, I'm in history, or I'm in wisdom, or I'm in prophecy, probably around this time in Old Testament history. That's going to give you a lot of base knowledge to go with your Bible study. Okay, so just some hints about how to read your Old Testament. Now let's go a little deeper. This is the second thing that I wanted to talk about. So let me ask you a question. What do you think is the best-selling book of all time? What is the best-selling book of all history? Anybody know? I'm hearing Bible. Okay? Anybody have a different response? Nope. Okay. Actually, at least according to the internet, the best-selling book of all time is A Tale of Two Cities by Charles Dickens, which has sold 200 million copies in its time. Second place, any Harry Potter fans? Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone is number 2 all-time bestseller, right? That's 120 million copies by 2021. So you're probably wondering, well, wait a minute, Bible has got to beat those two books. And it does. The Guinness Book of World Records says that there have been 5 billion copies of the Bible that have been distributed through time. That's probably a low number. It's probably a lot more. But the catch is best-selling, that's a distinction that isn't very old. They haven't been tracking it all that long. And it doesn't account for books that have been given away. And frankly, most Bibles, people get their Bibles because it was given to them as a gift from a church or for a family member. Just curious, your very first Bible, how did you get it? Was it by a gift? Raise your hand if it was a gift. Yeah, that's easily 75% of us got it as a gift. So that kind of skews things a little bit. But it doesn't really get to the main question, which is why? Why? Why is the Bible so popular? Why has it been read by so many people? Why do so many people want to distribute it and give it out to people? What is it about the Bible that makes it so awesome? And I don't know what your answer to it is, but for me, as I'm imagining what most people would say, if they could, is that the Bible does a really great job of telling us and showing us, revealing to us how we do this humaning thing. Being a human. I made up a word there. Humaning. We are always interested if a book can give us insight into how to lead a good life. Successful life. Happy life. And many, 5 billion, have found that the Bible does that. It does just that. So many people have had it. So many people have used it. There's all these folks that are using the Bible and turning to it, which must mean that it has some authority for them. That's the key word I want to think about today. Authority. What authority does the Bible have? In other words, does the Bible give you a standard by which you can measure yourself? You can go to the Bible and it will reveal to you, okay, I'm staying on the path. This is showing me that I'm being faithful to God, or it's really showing me I'm falling short of that. Something's amiss. What is it? The Bible gives you that information by which you can measure whether you are living that good, happy, successful life that you want to live. And that's what gives it authority. That's why you turn to it instead of turning to another authority about how to live your life. All right? So let's talk about authority. There are two types of authority: external and internal. What do you think external authority means? Or give an example of an external authority. Shout it out. What's that? Government. Okay. Yeah. What else? Judges. Okay. Judicial system. Teachers. Yeah. Parents. Yeah. So these are very good answers. These are influences outside of ourselves that we feel, for some reason, beholden to follow what they are telling us to do, to follow their guidance. Laws, the laws of the land, that's an example. Moral code, that's an example. Religious statutes and commandments, that's an example. Sometimes people invest authority in a person or in a group of people. But it is an outside influence, and really the reason that you are following that and you're taking that into account is you feel duty-bound, you know, as a citizen, or as a part of that religion, or as a part of that people group, whatever. Okay? Internal authority basically means that you have made a decision inside yourself. You know, this works. It works. It helps me make sense of my life and my decisions and my actions. It delivers the goods. You know, consistently, it helps me to live my life, it comes through for me. Now, a lot of people will say, they will tell you, if you ask them the question, what do you think the Bible is, external or internal authority? They will say external, because it's a book full of laws and commands and thou shalt nots. And people will say, well, yeah, that's how I use the Bible, as an external influence on my life. But if you read the Bible, it doesn't want to be an external influence only. It wants to be an internal influence more than anything else. It wants to be a resource that you use and you trust that it is God's own word, God's message, God's communication coming into your life. And that's what gives it the authority, is what's happening inside of you in your relationship with God. The proof of all this is how the Bible was really written. It was written by humans, but they weren't the only ones doing the writing. Someone else was too, throughout the whole thing, the whole Bible. And that someone, we believe, was the Holy Spirit. So in other words, the presence of God, the very real presence of God, was working in the formation of the Bible and how it was brought together and how it was organized in the form that we use today. Just like the Holy Spirit, that same Holy Spirit is working in you to bring order and organization and meaning and truth into your own life. It's the same Holy Spirit doing in you that it's trying to do through the scriptures for you. Is that making any sense? There's a scripture that I think covers this a little bit. And when it says prophecy, this is one of those verses where prophecy is kind of the synonym for the scriptures, like the revelation of God's word. So 2 Peter says, knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy, look at this, was ever produced by the will of humans, but humans spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So what happened is, as the Bible was put together, as the Bible was written, the Holy Spirit was guiding and inspiring that whole process. So the author of the Bible isn't just a group of humans, it is God himself, which makes it God's word. So that's really the only way we can say what we say about the Bible, that it is 66 different books that were written by about at least 35 different people who had professions everywhere from shepherd to king. It was written over the course of 1,500 years, that's 15 centuries, in three different languages. So if you think about, is there another example of something that brought together all these different things in the way the Bible has, that has the authority the Bible has? There's no example of this in the history of humanity. Nothing even comes close. To say that all of this is brought together in a way that works, it is a narrative from beginning to end. It helps us. It guides us. It's consistent. And it is well ordered, even though it comes from so many different places, so many different peoples, so many different time periods, so many different languages. That unity is because, it's the only reason. It has to be because of God's Holy Spirit. Along with that, let me get my place here again. The work didn't stop with the inspiration part, with the writing part. God does not want us to be left to our own devices saying, here, I created this book, now it's up to you to figure out what to do with it. So we believe that the Holy Spirit not only was a part of inspiration, but continues to be a part of every time the Bible's read, every time it's interpreted, and every time it's applied to daily life. In other words, the Holy, that same Holy Spirit is working right now as we are dealing with God's word right here. That same Holy Spirit is alive and active because we have seen what happens if we are left to our own devices in interpreting Scripture. What we like to do as humans, at least this is what our history says, is we like to take passages way out of context and use them to justify anything that we want to justify. It is justified. The Bible has been used to justify some of the most non-biblical things you can imagine, because people are doing it outside the work of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit flows through you whenever you pick up a Bible, start reading, whenever you log in and start reading, and in all those who, it's also in all those who are trying to help you, preachers, teachers, commentators, authors, Bible study, devotion writers, we're all being used by the Holy Spirit to help you understand what God's work is. And it's the same Spirit working in the church whenever we gather around God's word and try to understand its meaning for us and our mission for the church. So saying all that, it's the Holy Spirit that gives the Bible its authority. It comes from the mouth of God himself. That's what we believe. So to illustrate this, let's go to Psalm 119. It's taken us a long time to get here, but let's take a look at it now. Psalm 119, little trivia. Psalm 119 is the longest chapter of the entire Bible. It clocks in at 176 verses in one chapter, and it has almost 2,500 words. It's organized as an acrostic. If you're looking at it right now, and I hope you are, you may notice that there are section headings that have Hebrew letters. That's what they are, Hebrew letters. And so every verse in that section starts with that Hebrew letter. So it's very highly organized, very well thought out. But really, ultimately, what it's about is one person, the psalmist, the writer of this psalm, who is trying to give all of the different ways that they believe in the authority of Scripture. It's really, really cool. It's very repetitive, and it's always getting back to how is Scripture an authority in our lives. Look at verse 105, which is, I think, is the most well-known verse in Psalm 119. And it says, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path." Raise your hand if you've heard that verse before. Okay, that's most everybody. Very well known. "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path." Let's dig into this a little bit. Two words are given for illumination, right? Lamp, light. And that commentators say that's because there were two types of light that people used. One of which was a earthenware pot or dish that was filled with oil and had a taper, had a wick or a tallow that was coming out, and you would light that, and it would, because of the oil, it would continue to burn. This was used exclusively indoors. It was just too small to do much good outside. So when people went outside, they switched to a different kind of light, and that in those days was a torch. So it's a wad of flammable material that's been soaked in oil that's stuck on the end of a stick or a pole, and you can hold it up, and it sheds a lot more light in the area where you are. So what the psalmist is saying here is that no matter where I am, no matter what time of day it is, whether I'm in the darkness or in the light, I know that God's word is there for me. I know that it will shine a light on whatever situation I find myself in. So he goes on to, before I do that, light is a metaphor for God throughout the Bible. And darkness is a metaphor for doubt, confusion, and threat. So in other words, what the psalmist is saying here is that this is always a light for me, even if I find myself in the darkest, deepest, most isolated places in my life. If I feel like everybody's against me, I feel like I have no sense of self-worth, and the darkness is closing in around you. Have you ever been there? God's word is a constant source of light that will find you wherever you are. Let's go on. There's more good stuff he says. In verse 106, he says, I've taken an oath and confirmed it that I will follow your righteous laws. Look at that word, follow. In the Hebrew language, it's kind of interesting. In its root form, it was used to describe what a shepherd would do in the evenings. He would gather his flock in one place, and around them he would throw up a hedge with sticks and branches and things that would keep them from wandering off and would protect them from the threats of the night, predators and thieves. So what the psalmist is saying here really is he's saying, you know what? With God's word, I feel safe. When I'm following God's word, I know I'm in a secure place where God is protecting me. And then finally, skip to verse 108. This one I really like. Accept, O Lord, the willing praise of my mouth and teach me your laws. Look at that word willing. Basically, he is saying that of his own choice and his own volition, the psalmist is saying, this is what I turn to. I freely turn to this. There's really nothing else that matches this in terms of being an authority in my life. And because I believe in that so strongly, I've experienced that so vividly, before I go anywhere else, I'm going to God's word. So to kind of sum all this up, my prayer for you this week with this thing, with this Bible, is that it will transcend from being an external resource, kind of a reference that you turn to every once in a while when you need some help, or something that gives you all the laws and the things that you should be doing and obeying in your life. It will do that. This works as an external resource. If you are a non-Christian and you yet are looking for a guidebook for your life, this will do it. It'll work for you. But that's really not the depth of its power. It's not the way it wants to hit you in your mind only. It wants to reach into your heart, and it wants to reach into your soul. The Bible becomes the Bible when you open it up and you read it and you use it. That's when it becomes God's word, God's communication into your life. The Bible becomes the Bible when you prioritize its study. When you are wanting to grow in your understanding. That's why you're coming to church and you're going to Bible study. It's one of the reasons you want to grow in your understanding of God's communication for your life. And then finally, the Bible becomes the Bible when you believe it works. When you have experienced how well it works, and it's what you're going to turn to before you turn to anything else or let anything else influence you. This is going to be your resource for truth and for life. So I want to pray for you this week for those things so that together we can grow in God's word. Gracious God, I pray, Lord, that you would bless my friends and my fellow brothers and sisters in Christ with a deep internal appreciation of you and how you have spoken and how you've revealed yourself so willingly. You don't want to keep us in the dark. You don't want us to ever experience your silence. You are constantly speaking to us when we open up the pages of the Bible. I pray that there would be some in this room who would be inspired this week to not just use the Bible from time to time, but to really embark on an adventure of study and understanding. Really decide to learn more about the Bible. And then I pray that you would, with all of us as a church, really convict us and convince us that this Bible works in our lives. It is relevant for our lives. It is helpful for the lives that we are living now. It keeps us in the light, and it keeps us in the truth. I pray that this week, collectively, we would have a stronger sense of the Bible's power. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. The word beckons us to the table because it's in Scripture that we learn that on the night of Jesus' arrest, he gathered his disciples together in an upper room in Jerusalem. And during the course of their meal together, the Scripture says that Jesus took the bread and he blessed it, and then he broke it and he gave it to them, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this," he gave the command, "do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after they had eaten, Jesus took the cup, and pouring it out, he gave it to the disciples. And he said to them, "This is the cup of the new covenant, which is shed in my blood for the forgiveness of all sin. Drink of it, all of you," he said, "in remembrance of me." And so, whenever we gather and we have the bread and we have the cup, we are obeying Jesus' command because of our conviction that Jesus brings us peace. And Jesus brings us forgiveness and brings us healing. Jesus is the one that we want to proclaim in the world. We want other people to know of his love and his grace. And so it strengthens us for that work. So this is the Lord's table. All are invited to come and experience the goodness of God. So if you have your communion elements, let's start with the bread. And again, the Bible says that Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. All who come to me will never be thirsty. And all who believe in me will never hunger." This is the bread of life, the body of Christ, which is given for us. Thanks be to God. In the same way, Scripture says, "I am the vine and you are the branches." Jesus says, "Cut off from me, you can do nothing. But if you abide in me and you abide in my word, you will bear much fruit." And so this is the cup of salvation, the blood of Christ, which is given for us. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
So my friends, we have, over the last hour, we have sung praise to God and worshiped God. We have heard God speak to us from his word, and we have prayed, and we have received the elements, the bread and the cup. So there's really only one thing left to do, and that is to commit ourselves, to dedicate ourselves, to take this out there, to be God's workers, to be God's ambassadors of grace and goodness and truth in everything we say and everything that we do. And so, Lord, help us to dedicate ourselves right now for the very first time to follow Jesus, or to rededicate ourselves, maybe for the 100th time, to be his disciples in the world. Take and use our gifts, our talents, our time, our resources, everything that we have is offered to you to accomplish your purposes in the world. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God's grace to enfold you, the love of Jesus to uphold you, and the power of the Spirit to mold you and keep you in great joy. Have a great week. Go in peace.